Welcome to Soundscape Crusaders,
a music discovery podcast where we pair music with meaning.
Join co-hosts
Nate
and Levi on this journey
as we dive deep and examine one song an episode,
discuss what we love about it,
and then pair it with something that emotionally
and tonally
coincides with the song.
Just a Phase by Incubus.
Going, man, you see any good movies?
I feel like I just saw you like a couple days ago.
I guess technically you did.
Nothing new. I worked yesterday.
You finished King of the Hill.
I did finish King of the Hill, and I need something to like tide me over before JoJo comes back, which I'm so ready for JoJo's to come back. Dude, this villain is scary.
What did the estimations like supposed to be like April 1st or something, or like early April?
I think so. That's the assumption. I don't think really anything's ever has been set in stone.
Yeah, nothing I've seen. Do I look super pale? You look really tan.
Do I? I'm on the audition file. Oh, yeah, I do. What the fuck?
Yeah, why are
I'm
you
not this tan?
Did you actually have a pick?
I do.
You came up with one? I still can't. Genius gave me nothing.
Yeah, like, there's really nothing on Genius.
There's nothing about this song. I honestly, like, make fun of my critical thinking skills all you want, but I am not 100% sure if I know what this song's about. I mean, I can guess some things. And
it's pretty broad to the point where, like, it is very, you can like interpret it in a different way. I'm gonna pull up the lyrics.
Yeah, that's that's what I'm doing right now. There's Just a Phase by Adam Craig.
Like, cause like you can argue that, oh, maybe it's like a panic attack coming, or there was a comment on that Genius thread. Somebody made it, made a pretty interesting comparison about like trends in music and pop trends like that, like that's just a phase. I think it's right. Like pretty open for interpretation.
I mean, it's good that it's open to interpretation, because then you know, you don't have to be super strict to adhere to anything.
Right, that makes sense.
You go first, since you're
You want me to go first?
I mean, like, you don't have to say your pick yet. But just talk about the music.
Oh man, I've been listening to this song since probably sophomore year of high school. It's just one of those things. Like, it's like one of those things you stumble upon. Like, you buy a CD. Like, I had a CD player in my car, as well as like a lot of other people. But I'd always buy like a CD from Best Buy, because it's like, oh, I know this band. I don't know anything off that record. Or it's like, oh, I like that one song, but I don't know the other 13. And that CD was one of those kind of examples where it's like, oh, I like the song. I think it was Warning. I think it was the title. And I was like, I like that. So maybe the rest of it, it's good. And this was one of those songs that kind of just like really stuck out. To me, it's kind of like, it's like a three-act structure. Or like a three-course meal. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Because you kind of have like the initial build-up. Like, you have like the first act, which is like the first verse and the chorus. Hold on. How do I explain this?
I mean, the way it's kind of structured is it's not, you know, hit them in the stomach and then jump away.
Right. I'm also thinking like very sonically too. Maybe not. Okay, so it's not really a three-act structure. It's more of like a two-parter. You have this like creep up to this like moment, or what would you call it? The climax of the song. The first verse builds up to that first chorus, which like doesn't have that impact, you know, that punch. And it's like one of those moments where like you like think you're gonna throw up kind of deal, but it doesn't come up. I don't know. It just like it to me, it has like just such a really good punch to it. You know it's coming.
Yeah.
You know, it's like a jump scare in a horror movie, but even when it does happen, you're like, oh, that felt good.
Right.
You know, there's like a good feeling to it. So
you said you started listening to this when you were like 13 or something.
Oh, it was a. Is that how old you are in sophomore? I was a sophomore in high school.
Oh, not 13 then. Probably no. 15.
15, probably 15, 16. It's really when I started driving.
Oh, yeah, 15, 16.
Because by that time, like, cars had aux ports that you could, like, use and hook your phone up to, but I didn't have one, so I had to, like, do CDs or mix, you know, burn mixtapes and stuff like that. So I'd buy, like, a CD every other week at, like, Best Buy and stuff, because that's, like, kind of that end of that CD era.
Yeah, dude, aux ports were really short-lived, man. Like,
they weren't that good. They really, like the sound quality really wasn't that great. But it was cool because you could, like, hook your phone up, you know?
Right, right. Yeah, because, like, I feel like they started doing that when? Like, 2012? Maybe 10? Or was it? No, it had to be 8. I think 8 was the year, like, all cars started having them. Oh, wait.
Probably, like...
Like, new cars.
Yep. Seven later. Yeah, seven and later.
Yeah.
I mean, my car has an aux port, too. I just use the... I mean, I use the Bluetooth, but... I mean, they're still, like, really standard. Or I think they're in every car.
Yeah, I think I have one in my center console right now.
Okay.
But it's right next to one of the USB jacks, and the USB jack is so much cleaner audio.
Yeah.
Even, yeah. Dude, like, when my phone first hooks up to Bluetooth, you know, when you first get in the car or whatever?
Yeah.
And you turn it on and a song starts playing always. It sounds like shit when it's... And then it, like, you can tell immediately once I plug my phone in.
Yeah.
It, like, just... The sound it's quality better. Jumps yeah. so much
up. Sonically, it's just more full.
Yeah.
You know? It doesn't feel as distant. That's one thing I don't like about the Bluetooth, because you do lose that kind of oomph to it.
Yeah, it's like if you're driving around with really nice speakers, but you're just going through Bluetooth, it's not even worth it.
Right. You're like defeating the purpose.
Yeah, you might as well have the stock, you know? And stock's usually pretty good, too, mm-hmm. now. Anyway. I miss... while cars were having, before I got my car, once I graduated and was able to get my own, I was driving around a bunch of cars that didn't have, like, even CD players. I was hooking up the tape, you know, the tape with the cord that comes out.
Yeah.
Which sounds so ridiculous.
Those are popular, too. Because a lot of cars in, like, the mid to late 90s still had, tape decks, which is crazy.
Yeah.
But my dad still has all his cassette tapes, and they still sound super, super good. You know, it's just, if you take care of it, it'll be good. You'll be fine.
Tapes were cool. I liked tapes.
Yeah. And they're so goofy, but yeah, they're cool. They're pretty cool.
Yeah. Like, I probably wouldn't collect them, but I've seen people collect them, and that seems fun. Yeah. It makes more sense to me than collecting stuff like VHS tapes, where, like, I guess aesthetically they're cool, but they take up a lot of space, and it's not like it's good picture quality like Laserdisc or something.
Right.
So.
Right.
Anyway.
That's just my thoughts on the song. I think it's very... definitely has its, like, defined sections of the song. I think a part of it can, like, be equated to... Not lyrically, but, like, sonically, kind of like a panic attack, because you have that anxiety building and then it doesn't hit. And you think it's going to be good, and then the anxiety builds again and then it hits. And then, like, when the, you know, the big crescendo happens and the music just gets quicker and stuff, it's kind of like that's, like, the panic attack, and then eventually you calm down.
Yeah, yeah. That's a great... Yeah, I love that, because the first time I listened to it, because I hadn't heard this song before, like, you think just for a second... that it's just like everything's going to just hit, because they like hold it for a second. It's just a, and you're like, oh, yeah, they're about to go hard right now, and then it, and then they just kind of like softly, instead of like jumping over you, they slide under you.
It's kind of like starts from square one again, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, that's a very good point. They're really, it's really good at faking you out almost. I like the slide under you thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's a good analogy.
See, and since I don't have a pick yet, this is helping me kind of figure it out, because it's like, okay, we're looking for something that's a little longer, but it doesn't have an immediate climax, but
has a hell of a payoff kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, my pick is, it's a little too on the nose, but I think if I can explain it for like a minute or two, I think it makes sense. Also, if you don't know what this is, it's going to be like super, super hard to explain. But I think you might have known what it was.
Is it a movie, game, show?
It's a video game.
Video game. Oh, you're two for two on video games.
Yeah, yeah. I took this very literally, like a phase, like it's a short period of time kind of thing. So I kind of took that literally. So my pick, did you ever play a game called Jack 2?
We've got a baron to overthrow, a child heir to protect, an invasion of metalheads to stop, and a city to save.
Did you ever play Jack and Daxter?
I know of it. I didn't play it a lot. It's a platformer though, right?
Right. So in the sequel, you get like this really, like a, you get this ability that turns you into like, I wouldn't say, I guess you look like a demon and you're just like, you know, enhanced strength, enhanced speed, stuff like that. It's literally a phase of time where you are like at your heightened rage and anger, kind of like in the song.
Right.
It kind of builds to that, you know, concoction of just noise. So that's kind of like what came to my mind when I was...
So specifically Jack 2?
Yes. I think that is my choice.
J-A-K 2.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So for anyone that doesn't know... Oh, Naughty Dog made it.
Yeah.
I didn't know they were around.
I want to say Jack and Daxter was like a launch title for the PS2. Oh, so they've been around for a hot minute.
Yeah, it's the second game in the Jack and Daxter series and is the sequel to Jack and Daxter, the precursor legacy.
Yes. Two's fun. Two is really fun.
It's made by Naughty Dog, published by Sony. So that makes sense why.
Yeah. It was definitely a console exclusive. It was never on Xbox. It was the counterpoint to Ratchet and Clank, because they came out around the same time, their first games. So they were the foils of each other, if you want to.
So what would you say the abilities are like? Can you go more into detail, like what the gameplay is like?
So it's a 3D platformer. And in the sequel, so in the first one, it's like a collectathon. Right. You know, you have to get your jiggies and your, you know, your music notes, your bananas, you know, but the equivalent for that universe. And then the sequel, they kind of made it Grand Theft Auto for kids that aren't old enough to play Grand Theft Auto. Does that make sense?
Gotcha. Gotcha.
So you lived in this, like, this world, and you have you have missions that they send you all over. You can hijack cars, you can just attack random people, you get guns, stuff like that. And in the story, you're like experimented on, and you basically become like the Hulk in a sense. You're really quick, so you just fly around the map, scratching the hell out of every enemy, because your nails increase in length.
Huh.
It's kind of like that.
Looks cool. I'm going to look up a trailer. Let's see what the...
It was very edgy because the first game was rated E for everyone, and the sequel was rated T for teen. So, like, I had to convince my mom to, like, buy it for us.
Oh, man. I love this era of graphics.
Mm-hmm.
It was, like, a little more advanced than the, like, 64.
Mm-hmm.
But still simple enough to where it's not just, like, overcomplicated.
Yeah.
Which is, like, you don't realize how that kind of sometimes... changes a game until you play like a remaster or something.
Right.
You know, like, for example, Halo 2, like the remaster, you don't see stuff as well. Like the gameplay direction is lost when you when you get that quality. I mean, I feel like it is.
Because, so are the colors not as vibrant
when they make it remastered? Yeah, because, you know, they make it more realistic. Because
the grunts and jackals, like, pop.
Right.
That's the point.
Yeah, they pop out. And even, even like, the blood is, like, more...
More vibrant, maybe?
Vibrant, yeah. Sticks out. This looks cool.
It's that game was fun. That game was really, really fun. My brother and I loved the hell out of that game.
It looks fun. He's like jumping around, kicking stuff.
That's essentially it. Just kick the shit out of things.
It's an interesting pick. I'm still thinking
about it. I'm 2 for 2 on the fucking video games, man.
Yeah, I mean, video games are good. My only consolation is that this could not last forever, even though you're singing and thinking how well you've got it made. Man, I keep on, like, leaning towards something because the vibe...
That sounds like a panic attack. That sounds like a panic attack coming, just that lyric alone.
Yeah, yeah, like he's about to explode, and then he doesn't. He holds back. So would you say that's, like, anger? Like, or
it could
fear?
Be rage.
Yeah.
I guess I think I would probably lean more rage, but I think fear, you could argue that as well.
And he's like,
I just wouldn't know how to.
He's going to be like, this is going to be over soon. It's just a phase. Everything will be better as time passes. So he's like stuck in a rut. You know, maybe the repetition of life, or he's stuck in like just, he's stuck in this place.
You're working through it.
Yeah, I'm working through it. It's gonna come to me. I'm just trying to, like, I don't know. This one didn't really come easily to me like last week. Verse that really trips me up and gets me really just confused on which direction I want to go is Call It Women's Intuition. But I think I'm onto something here. Temporaryism has been the black plague and the Jesus of our age. I know that I sound opinionated, maybe biased, and quite possibly jaded, but sooner than later... they'll be throwing quarters at you out on stage. So I'm going to go with something. Let's see. He sounds like an old soul. Maybe he is old. He's tired of shit, right?
You go on the anger route?
Yeah, I think he's a little angry, and he keeps on telling himself that it's gonna end soon. This is going to be the last of... This is the last of it. I'm on the precipice of something great.
Good word. It's a good word.
I do like that word. Sometimes I say words that are big that I really don't know whether or not I'm using it correctly or not.
Taking a lucky guess, essentially.
Yeah, yeah. And usually, I mean, people might be second guessing me, but, you know, but they don't do it to my face. So,
right.
At least there's that. I got it.
All right, let's hear it.
So I'm going to go kind of the heist route, because I feel like this guy keeps on saying that this is going to be over soon. You know, maybe he's telling someone that. Maybe he's telling himself that. He's jaded. He's angry. So what I'm going to go with, and I think it fits, is Steven Soderbergh's No Sudden Move.
You said a man want to see me.
Alley out back.
Can't come in. What is he, white?
Oh, boy.
So what's the score?
Came out in 2021. It was last year. Great cast. It was written by Ed Solomon, who did like the Men in Black movies, Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure and Bogus Journey.
Okay.
And then directed by Steven Soderbergh, huge cast of Don Cheadle, Benicio Del Toro, David Harbour, John Hamm, Amy Simetz. Does that sound right? I'm just going to say it confidently.
Yeah, she was in the Pet Sematary remake. I didn't that thought it was all right, but I don't know. Brendan Fraser's in this.
Brendan Fraser, Kieran Culkin.
I do like Brendan Fraser. He looks happy.
And Kanye's bae.
Oh, Julia Fox. Julia Fox.
And then, if you know, if you have like a mob-ish type movie, you got to have Ray Liotta in there. So,
of course.
Goodfellas and Bill Duke.
Is like, oh, really?
Yeah. Okay. Like, dude, it's like you recognize every single name in this movie. And then I'm not going to get into it, but there's like more people that just pop in because Steven Soderbergh is like a god and can somehow get all of these big actors to come in for just like 5 minutes. Right.
That's a very good point. That's a very good point.
It's absolutely nuts. Let me see if I can find a quick synopsis. In 1954 Detroit, small-time criminals are hired to steal a document. When their heist goes horribly wrong, their search for who hired them and for what purpose sends them wending through all the echelons of the race-torn, rapidly changing city. Anyway, I almost went with Logan Lucky, but I feel like no sudden move made more sense. Logan Lucky is also fun.
That's a good choice.
Logan Lucky or
the one you picked.
Oh, no sudden move. Yeah. I like it.
I like the mafia kind of heist turn. You went with the song. Didn't see that coming.
And it's since the song is like really restrained in the same way, I think the movie is as well. It knows how to keep you interested without completely, giving everything away on the forefront. So I think it's really great. Well, you haven't seen it, so there's not much left to add.
Yeah, it's going to have to be one of those I put on my list and just get to it when I can.
All right, that's the show, Nate. I went with No Sudden Move, 2021, by Steven Soderbergh.
And I went with Naughty Dog's Jack 2, came out in 2003.
Sweet. I'll go try to play the game, and you try to watch
the
movie.
And I'll watch the movie. Yeah, it's going to be good.
Sounds good.
I'm excited. Every new thing I learn here, it's just going to be something new to enjoy.
Right. That's the goal of this, is basically just discovering new music and also other new media that no one has tried. And so far, at the very least, I'm discovering a lot of music, which is really fun, coming from someone who just doesn't. I've been stuck in a rut for a long time, musically. Like this guy in the song. All right, let's see. Now it's time to pick the song of the week. Next week, we will be discussing Flower of Sex by Merchandise. Do you know that one?
No, I have no idea.
Okay,
cool.
Hell yeah. Cool. That's never two in a row that you didn't know, so I'm doing good.
And this one, I've never even heard of the band, so.
Yeah.
I
like the vibe of this song. Yeah.
Okay. Put it in the playlist and I'll listen to it tonight.
Yeah. Let me actually find it in my playlist because I'm on shuffle.
Is there what's it called? Can, like,
Flower of Sex.
Flowers and Sex or Flowers of Sex?
Or just Flower of Sex. There we go.
Oh.
It's in the playlist.
Merchandise is the... Okay.
Is our playlist public?
I think so. It's public because the option right now is make it private.
Oh, gotcha.
Thanks for listening, everyone. Thanks for listening. Next episode, we will be discussing
Flower of Sex by Merchandise.
Follow us on Twitter at Sound Crusaders for upcoming episodes and a link to our Spotify playlist. I'll be back.